I love the Easter season, man. We got our daughter a dress. We've got eggs galore, lots of candy, lots of food, lots of fun. And I called my parents recently. My dad, he doesn't go to church very often. He goes twice a year. He goes Christmas and Easter. So I called him and I'm like, hey, Dad, you going to go to church? And he's like, yeah, you know, it's about that time of year again. I'm like, yeah. They're in a new town, though, so he's got to find a new church. And he's like, Josh, I go to church twice a year. I already know what's going to happen. It's either Jesus is born or Jesus comes back from the dead. It's like, it's predictable. I'm like, Dad, you know other stuff happens, right? He's like, yeah, but I'm not interested in that. So we're still talking that out, figuring that out. But I think a lot of you might be like my dad, where you go, I don't regularly attend. I'm not actually a believer in Christ, but because of the season it is, I'll come check this out. And I think there's some legit reasons for that. Like if we were to bring you on stage and set you up here and give you a mic and you were to tell us why you're not a Christian, why you're not a follower of Jesus, I think there's some legit reasons for a lot of you. You go, man, you don't know the Christians I used to know. Like, those people are the worst. I don't like them at all. And honestly, they probably were the worst, and I wouldn't like them either, right? But there's something about the people you grew up around, or you have some questions, or you've been through some hard stuff in your life, and you find yourself in a place going, I could never believe, but I entertain some stuff every now and then, religious activity. But let's pretend it turned, and you said to me, Josh, I'll give you one shot, though. I'll give you one shot to tell me, why do you think I should become a follower of Jesus? Why should I consider this? One shot. Why should I believe? Well, the good news is I would not start defending those Christians that you don't like that much, because I probably don't like them either, right? And I wouldn't start defending church history or politics or any of that stuff. I wouldn't even start to tell you how great it would be if you followed Jesus and go, it's going to make your life better and you're going to get rich. I wouldn't tell you, because that's actually not true. I wouldn't tell you any of that stuff, because the foundation of Christianity isn't Christians. Isn't that great news? The foundation of Christianity isn't the church. It isn't even church history. The foundation of Christianity isn't a bunch of really good stuff that happens to your life if you believe. None of those things are the foundation. The foundation of Christianity is an event. And it's an event called Easter. It's an event where Jesus, the founder of Christianity, where he fulfilled a promise. He did something in an event, and that event took a lot of people and sent them forward into a movement that you and I are still seeing happening all around us today. Jesus, the founder of this movement, is the one I would start with. So why should you consider following Jesus? I would say you should consider not all these other things and all these other people, but you should start with Jesus, who was a real person, who experienced a real event called Easter. But even before that, there were people that saw Jesus get born, and there were people that were eyewitnesses to him getting older. There were people that saw him start to do miracles. Like, he fed 5,000 people with 2 loaves of bread and 5 fish. Or was it 5 loaves and 2? It doesn't matter, right? Massive miracle involving some kids' lunch. So 5,000 people saw this happen. People saw him walk on water. People saw him pick up people that couldn't walk anymore and they could walk. People saw him raise a dead man. People heard him predict his death. I'm going to die and I'm going to rise again. Then people saw him get arrested. People saw him get wrongfully accused. People saw him get beat. People saw him get nailed to a cross. People saw him come off the cross. People saw him get put into a tomb. You tracking this? People saw the tomb get put a huge stone in front of the tomb. People saw soldiers go in front of the tomb to guard it so that nothing could get in or out. People saw this whole thing go down. And on Easter morning, some women went to the tomb and they were going to wash Jesus' body. And they saw, eyewitnesses saw that the tomb was empty. And they did exactly what you and I would have done. They took to social media and told everybody. This is before iPhones and the internet, but I guarantee you they would have taken a selfie in the empty tomb. I know it. It's just who we are as people. But they didn't have that media, so they just run back into town. They start testifying. Jesus, who we saw was alive, Jesus, who we saw was dead, Jesus, who we saw put in the tomb, is now raised to life again. We saw it. We were there when it happened. This is so significant in the story that these eyewitnesses start to promote this as if it's the truth. And you're like this too. I remember a couple years ago when the WSU football team beat the Oregon Ducks in that double overtime game. I was there. I saw it. We were a part. I wasn't there, but I saw it on the phone, right? We were at a conference. We postponed the conference to watch the end of the game. We were supposed to start this event, and we're all in the hallway watching the game. And you know, this was like a Resonate event, so like University of Oregon is there, and like the Cougs beat them, and it was awesome. Sorry, U of O, right? So it was amazing. The Cougar fight song spontaneously broke out in the crowd. Like people started cheering, and then it was like, as soon as it was over, it was like, all right, let's start our event. But I was there, I saw it. So if, for instance, someone were to come to you and go, yeah, that actually didn't happen, they didn't win, you'd be like, whoa, 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 whoa. You would be offended. Hey, you didn't see what I posted online. You didn't see that we were there. And then if you were actually in the stadium, you would even be more offended because you'd be like, no, 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 I saw it. I was there. And something happened that you saw, and then you became a testimony to what happened. This is what happened in the garden when the tomb was empty. The movement of Christianity was birthed when people saw an empty tomb. And some people think it may have been a scandal, and now they're just keeping secrets. But if you know anything about how secrets work, this is not the kind of secret you want to keep because it's so dangerous to your life. I was doing some research, and in 1970, you guys know the Watergate scandal? Some of you are like, whoa, dude, I was not born. I don't want to talk about that. So 1970, there was a scandal where President Nixon and his administration were a part of wiretapping some buildings in D.C. Illegally, and it was the Watergate scandal because one of the buildings was called Watergate. And so there was a group of men that were trying to keep this secret, and one of them's name was Chuck Colson. His nickname was the Hatchet Man. I don't know what your nickname is, but the Hatchet Man is pretty hardcore. Like, hey, Chuck, nice to meet you. He's like, call me the Hatchet Man. Like, no, thank you. I read a book in high school called Hatchet. I don't want to call anyone the Hatchet Man. Right, so he gets in trouble. He has to go to prison for this. And in prison, Chuck Colson comes to faith in Christ. Like, he becomes a believer in Christ. And I was reading about this, and here's what Chuck Colson said. He actually started a prison ministry where like, for years now, he's been sharing the gospel in prisons. So here's what he says. He says, I know the resurrection is a fact, and Watergate proved it to me. How? Because 12 men testified that they had seen Jesus raised from the dead, and then they proclaimed that truth for 40 years, never once denying it. Every one of them was beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. They would have never endured that if it weren't true. Watergate embroiled 12 of the most powerful men in the world, and they couldn't keep alive for 3 weeks. You're telling me 12 apostles could keep alive for 40 years? Absolutely impossible. So if you were to say, Josh, why should I consider Christianity? I would say you should consider Christianity because Jesus rose from the dead, and that is worth your consideration. And human history has been affected by that. Every time you write a date on a document, you write what day it is, you are referencing the resurrection of Jesus. Even what year it is right now. And this resurrection had massive implications. People had to share this story everywhere. That's how you got your New Testament. People had to tell the story of the resurrection. So this guy named Matthew, he was an eyewitness. He wrote about this account. There's a guy named Luke who wasn't an eyewitness, but he interviewed eyewitnesses to write the account. And Jesus had a little brother named James who wrote a book of the Bible telling about the resurrection, clarifying and confirming what Jesus had done. So just for fun, how many of you have younger siblings? How many of you have a younger sibling? Yeah? How many of you could get your younger sibling to worship you as God? A couple of you? Most of your younger siblings think you would make a great dictator, but not a great God. Most of them don't even like you that much, right? That whole love, hate. Like, if you were to say, hey, your brother is saying he's sinless and would like people to worship him, then your younger siblings would be like, he said, what? I grew up with him. He's the worst. James, the brother of Jesus, starts worshiping him, telling the story to the ends of the earth. It's profound. And there's another guy named John who was one of Jesus' best friends, and he wrote one of the Gospels. And in his Gospel, there is a passage, there is a scripture that is now being blasted in all kinds of places where you've probably seen this, whether you know it or not or whether you're familiar with it or not. It is everywhere. So girls, you can affirm this. Guys, don't answer this. But if you shop at Forever 21, you guys heard of Forever 21? The guys are like, don't bring it up. It's where I go and spend too much time while the girl picks clothes, right? So there's this store called Forever 21, and they put John 3:16 on the bottom of their bags. Have you seen this? It's like on there. You're like, I never look in the bottom, Josh. I just pull out all the clothes I got. So cool. The second greatest restaurant in the world behind Chick-fil-A is one called In-N-Out Burger. They put it on the bottom of their cups. Like, you've got John 3:16. I don't know if you're cheering for Chick-fil-A or In-N-Out, but I'll take either one. They put that on the bottom of their cups to explain what is going on in the story. There's a There's a football player named Tim Tebow who won the national championship and also won the Heisman Trophy. And here's how he gave his post-game interview to the national championship game. Brother's got John 3:16 on his eyes. Like for all the world to see. I have another photo. I didn't bring it, but there's this guy running on a baseball field with the John 3:16 sign, and there's like a dude running behind him about to tase him. Just Google that. It's amazing. Taser boy. So this is coming at you everywhere. You can't go shopping. You can't get food. You can't watch football without John 3:16 coming at you. So I want to read to you John 3:16. What is this message? What is so important that they're putting it everywhere? Is it worth our consideration? John 3:16 says this. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Even if you don't have any church background, you probably have heard this verse. And the reason why this verse is so famous is because in one sentence, you get the whole story. In one sentence, you get the whole story. And so you ask, why should I consider this? Well, let's start with the beginning of this verse. This verse says, God so loved. So right away, we're introduced to a God who created, a God who sustains, a God who made all this possible. And it says this God is doing something. This God in this passage is doing something, and he's not keeping a score so that he can punish you later. This God in the story is not angry. He's not mad. He's not an old man with a white beard. He's not Santa Claus with the Easter Bunny. He's not a vending machine where you go, hey, I put in my money, man. Give me my snacks, right? None of these things are happening in the story. He's doing something. And apparently, he's the one that knows how all this is supposed to work because he created all this. So you can trust him. You can say, okay, God, what are you saying to me? He's active in the story, and what he is doing is loving. He's loving. He's not yelling. He's not screaming. He's not angry. He is loving. And I submit to you that he is loving because that is the thing that you most need and most want. So believe it or not, why you should consider becoming a Christian is because Christianity offers you what you most want. You most want to be loved. You most want to be loved. I know some of you are like, whoa, not me, man. Now, you can call it lots of different things, but at the end of the day, you most want to be loved. You can call it acceptance. You can call it approval, security, identity, whatever. But when you're standing in the gym, fellas, in front of the mirror with your biceps on, don't forget leg day. When you're doing that, you're asking someone to love you. You're looking for love. You want to be loved. Some of you go back to people who have hurt you and mistreated you and been terrible to you because of how desperately you want to be loved. Some of you have allowed people into your life that have just been the worst because of how badly you want to be loved. Some of you continue to let people, they're like repeat offenders towards you, but you don't even care because of how badly you want to be loved. And I submit to you, that's a good thing. That's a thing God put in there so that God could love you. You most want to be loved. In 1993, there was a singer named Meatloaf. Isn't that the worst name ever for a singer? Does he not have any friends that could help him? I'll never forgive him for that band name. Meatloaf. Think about it. Bad idea, right? Okay, Meatloaf. He had a song, his most famous song. Meatloaf's most famous song was called I'd Do Anything for Love, But I Won't Do That. I'd do anything for love, but I won't do that. You may have heard of this song, even if you don't know who Meatloaf is. There is an entire Wikipedia page designated to try to figure out what Meatloaf won't do for love. There are like two main questions in all the world. What am I here for? Why are we existing? What is it that Meatloaf won't do for love? An entire page designated to this question. I submit to you, you want to be loved. And there's almost nothing you won't do to get love. You want that. It's pursuing that. But I'll take it a step further. You don't just want to be loved because that's too superficial. You don't just want superficial, shallow love. You actually want to be loved by someone who knows you, who sees you, who understands you, who likes you. You want to be loved and liked. You want someone who can know what's going on in your world and go, man, you don't just love me superficially. Like, you've seen me at my worst. You know my quirks. You know my issues. You know my insecurities. And in that moment when I'm most exposed, you love me anyways. You don't just want love. You want to be loved, and you also want to be known. And so in this scripture, you don't just see God loving superficially, he actually says who he loves. And this word of who he loves, that's where you and I get to see who we are in this story, that God knows us. So the word that's used in this passage is the word world. God so loved the world. Now, you and I think that the world is like the globe that you see from space, you know, from NASA's Instagram page or whatever. You think about that being the world, and that's fair. But John, when he talks about the world, what he's referencing is something much different than that. He's referencing a mass of humanity, a group of people. This humanity that John is talking about is a fallen and rebellious people who cannot save themselves. John is saying that when you think about yourselves, you have to recognize that you are fallen and you are broken, and you know you can't save yourself. So God knows you and he loves you, and he knows that there's something restless going on in your heart, and there's an attempt on your behalf to save yourself, and you can't. I believe that you know that about yourself, that you know you're restless. You know that there's some stuff that's hard in this life, and you know that you're not sure how to figure it out, and you have some questions. I was in this room 7 years ago, this very room. I was sitting in the back because I was late, and I got a bad seat, but I came to this event where there was a debate happening between a Christian pastor and an atheist professor. They were debating on the existence of God like 7 years ago. And they're going back and forth. You've got critics on both sides, and there's lots of issues going on in the scenario. But at the very end of the debate, each one of them is given a chance to give like their final remarks. And so the atheist professor debater guy goes first, and he says, I would like to close by reading from the words of Jesus. And I'm like, what? You're going to do what? Please read Jesus. Like, that's awesome. So he decides he's going to read Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. And I want to read to you what this guy reads. Matthew 11, 28. Then Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I'll give you rest. And this atheist debater stood up in front of this whole crowd, 500 people in the crowd, and he says, Jesus says, if you're tired, if you're hurting, if you're weary, come to him and he'll give you rest. So I say to you, if any of you are tired, if any of you are weary, if any of you are hurting, I suggest you go to Jesus. And I'm in the back like, what? And you see the Christian pastor guy over here just like putting away his notes. Like, I will not be saying my final remarks because of what you just said. And so then the atheist debater guy says, I don't think Jesus can actually satisfy, so test it. And so the Christian pastor's like, hey, actually, we have disagreed on everything tonight except that. I agree, you should go to Jesus if you're weary, if you're tired, if you're burdened, if you're heavy laden, and I just think we're different. I believe Jesus will give you rest. And then he went further. He said, I believe Jesus will give you the rest that you most want, the rest that you most desire, the rest that you are most seeking after. I believe you're restless and you know it. And you're weary and you know it. I believe you know there's something off in you. How do I know that? Because I know that about me, and I know self-help books are flying off the shelves. And I know if you want to get rich, all you got to do is find a new diet, find a new way to do life, find a new way to administrate your schedule, find a new way to do anything. Everybody's broken and trying to fix it. Have you noticed? Everybody. Everyone is weary. Everyone is broken. And Jesus is the only one that doesn't say, try this, try that. Here's a new idea. Jesus says, come to me. I am the rest you're after. What a bold statement. What a profound idea that is what he's after. Now, in this moment, when you realize, man, Jesus can offer me love and know, he can know me and love me, what usually happens in this moment is you start to disqualify yourself from God's love. That's what usually happens. How do I know that? Because in 10 years of doing this, the amount of conversations I've had with you guys, hundreds, where students come and they say, man, I would like to be a Christian, but I could never be a Christian. Here's what they say. I wrote this down. I could never be a Christian because I'm too sinful. I've slept with too many people. I struggle with addiction. I'm too angry. I'm too sad. I drink too much. I'm too unlovable. I did this or I did that or have this in my past or have that in my past. I'm too much. God could never love me. God could never want me. God could never love me. God could never love me once he got to know me. And I want to look at people and I say, listen, what's happening in the Bible is not just that God loves you, it's that God is love. So what you have to understand about God is love is this, that God is love, therefore to God, it is impossible to be unlovable because he is a God who is love. So you don't get to set the parameters on whether or not God loves you because of who his character is and what he's about. He's not going to go against his character when he says, I am love, therefore I love you. You cannot do anything to disqualify from my love. In other words, what makes you lovable to the world is not what makes you lovable to God. In the world, you got to earn it. You got to work out a lot. You got to dress a certain way, say a certain thing. And that's the only way you can get acceptance. And God says, I actually know you and I actually love you just as you are. Just as you are. This is a distinctly Christian thing, that God loves you just as you are and you don't have to earn it. But even more than that, it's not just that God loves you, it's even when you were rebelling against him and running the other way. The Bible says when you were his enemy, he loved you. So I still submit to you, you want to be loved and you most want to be loved by someone that knows you. And God is willing to do that to you, but you're still going to find yourself saying this, God doesn't want me. Some of you in the room might still be thinking, God doesn't want me. You don't understand. Well, this next part of the passage not only shows you that he wants you, it shows you how much he wants you. And it should startle you. It should startle you how much he wants you. So the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. He loved you so much, he didn't just write you a card. He didn't just send flowers. This is not vague. This is not sentimental. This is not emotional. This is not feelings. This is action-oriented at the highest of cost. This is God saying, not only do I love you, I will show you I love you. I'll show you how much I love you by sending my greatest asset. My greatest asset I will send to you. You and I can't even share something. Like if it's our last thing, like we don't even share what our last thing is. That's how selfish we are. Can you imagine if it's your greatest asset? God sends forth his greatest asset. And through these actions, you have to hear this. By sending forth his son, God is saying, I see you. I know the state you're in. I understand you. And I love you all the same. I see you. I know you. I love you all the same. And I alone can make it right. And I submit to you that in your soul, if you're honest this afternoon, that is what you most want in your soul. You most want to be loved. You most want to be known. And what stirs you up more than anything else is when you see self-sacrificial love take place. That is why the gospel story, when it is shown in other things like movies and stuff, something inside of you starts to stir and you find yourself crying over stuff. Anytime you see self-sacrificial love, there's something in your heart that knows you want that. So you're watching Titanic, right? Maybe you don't watch that movie. Maybe you do. But when Jack gives up the board for Rose, something inside of you goes, man, Jack, find another board, right? No? Oh, something inside of you is like, wow, isn't that the way it's supposed to be? Jack is so loving that he gives it up for Rose. And you're like, they should take turns or something. Jack, you should try harder. But maybe that's not your jam. But something inside of you when it sees sacrificial love is moved by it. Maybe you don't watch Titanic. Maybe for you, it's the movie Frozen, right? Anna runs over and stands in front of the sword before Elsa takes a killing blow, and something inside of you gets choked up when you see Anna self-sacrificing for Elsa. Self-sacrificial love stirs you. Everyone in Rogue One dies, and you love that movie. You love it because they got the USB port out and Death Star is going down. You love Rogue One. Don't even get me started on Harry Potter. How every single person, mom, dad, Snape, Dumbledore, not Voldemort, he's the worst. They all self-sacrifice for Harry so that when Harry faces Voldemort, he can self-sacrifice. And the only thing evil can't conquer is someone who self-sacrificially gives their life. That's why you're stirred in that moment. That's why you're crying in book 7. This snuck up on me recently. My wife Amy and I were in Coeur d'Alene at a hotel, and we decided we are going to rent a movie. And we picked Pixar's animated movie, Inside Out. Have you seen this movie, Inside Out? It is amazing. Go home and watch it later. It's a great movie about a little girl named Riley, and there's some stuff happening in Riley's mind, all these emotions that are going on. And one of her emotions is called joy, and joy is trying to find her way through Riley's brain. And a significant part in the movie, Joy finds herself stuck in the abyss with Riley's imaginary friend, Bing Bong. And they are trying their best to get out of the abyss, because if you're in the abyss, you're forgotten about and Riley can't remember you. They're trying their best to get out of the abyss, but there's a massive cliff that they've got to jump up and get on. And so they have this cart, right? And they're riding this cart trying to get up to this cliff, and they can't do it, and they can't do it, and they can't do it. And finally, Bing Bong says, I have an idea. Let's go one last time, as hard as we can go, as fast as we can go, we're going to make it. So they do it one last time, and they fly off the ledge, and they start heading to the place where they can finally receive the rescue. And right before they get there, right at the place where they're about to lose their momentum, Bing Bong jumps off the cart and pushes with all of his might so that Joy can make it over the ledge. And it just blows me up in that hotel room. Like, I am awkwardly crying. And my wife is like, bro, what is wrong with you? Why are you crying? And I'm like, Bing Bong is Jesus. Bing Bong is Jesus. He goes into the abyss so that Riley can have joy. Jesus went into the abyss so I could have joy. Blown up by Inside Out. Because anytime you see self-sacrificial love, you know you want it. I submit to you, it's what you were created for. Whether it's Titanic or Saving Private Ryan or whatever it is, something inside of you goes, hey, that's the way it should be. Maybe I was created for that. Maybe that's the way it's supposed to be. What the Bible's trying to say is that God loves you enough to sacrifice for you. Not only does God love you, and you most need that, he knows you. And you most need the love and you most need the knowledge. And then to take it a step further, he's willing to sacrifice for you. So what you most want is someone to love you. What you most want is someone to know you. What you most want is someone to sacrifice for you. And what you see in this passage is God giving his only son because he so loved you. He didn't just love you. He so loved you. And it wasn't just his son. It was his one and only son. It was his greatest asset because he so loved you. And so maybe you're in the room and you're like, all right. Maybe so, Josh. Maybe I want to be loved. Maybe I want to be known. Maybe I cried during Inside Out. Okay, maybe. Maybe something happens to me when I see self-sacrificial love. Maybe something inside of me wants that. But so what? Why does it even matter? Those are just emotions. Those have any consequence. So what? And here's the hard part. This is the so what. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. And here's the turn. That whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. So you most want to be loved. You most want to be known. You most want to have someone self-sacrifice to you. And this is available. What you most want is available, but a choice is demanded. And what you see next in this passage is a crossroads right in your path. A crossroads. If God loved you enough to send his son, then I need to love you enough to tell you that there are eternal consequences to your decisions. Eternal consequences. And I know that's not fun because you're like, bro, I'm young. I have a lot of time to live. Let me just live it up. No. There are eternal consequences to your decisions. And there's a crossroads in front of you. It is incredibly clear that there are two options. You either perish in unbelief or live in belief. And both of these things are eternal. There is no side deal. There is no third option. There is no other way. There is no other life. There is no other truth. This is what is before you. The invitation is super simple. You can believe in Jesus and live eternally, or reject Jesus and perish eternally. That's the crossroads in this passage. Everlasting joy or everlasting sorrow. Everlasting light or everlasting darkness. Everlasting union with your creator or everlasting separation from your creator. And this is what is at stake. This is why Easter matters. This is what is so significant. And in this moment, this is so important for you in this moment, you have to actively reject. Right now, you have to actively reject the thoughts that are going on in your mind where you start to think, that's not true, or God couldn't love me, or you know what, I'll just be good enough. I'll be a good person, and when I get to heaven, we'll put all my good on one side and all my bad on the other, and as long as my good outweighs my bad, doesn't that mean I'm cool? Doesn't that mean that's what God's after? And you can radically misunderstand this message. This message has nothing to do with good and bad. This message has everything to do with dead and alive. Jesus did not come to the world to make bad people good. He came to the world to make dead people alive. And the resurrection, Easter, this whole thing proves that Jesus has the authority to do that because God can raise the dead. The resurrection story is so powerful and so important and so profound because when Jesus was dead, he got raised to life. That means it's true that while we are dead, we can be made alive. This is so significant for us. The resurrection power to bring the dead to life is available to you. And that's why it's called good news. But the difficulty is, man, God's not going to force you. He's not going to coerce you. He's not going to manipulate you. He's not going to force you because that's not how love works. Love invites, love offers, love persuades, love woos, but it doesn't force. And so God is standing before you offering to you what you most want. You most want to be loved. You most want to be known. You most want to be sacrificed for. And he offers that to you, but you have to take it. You have to believe that and receive that and trust him. Some of you might know this about me, some of you might not, but for the last 2.5 years, my wife and I have been in a process to adopt a little girl from China. And last week, we booked our plane tickets. It's finally going to go down on May the 8th. And if you don't know a lot about adoption, which I did not, you can misunderstand what happens in that initial meeting. So we've been praying for her. We've been like sacrificing for her. We like moving rooms around in the house. People are giving us money for this fundraiser. Like it's an incredible endeavor. And that little girl doesn't know any of that's happened. And so on May the 8th, we're going to walk into a room, my wife and I, and our daughter, Lucy, is going to walk into the room, probably being held by her nanny, the only woman that she knows and trusts and loves. And her nanny's going to turn and hand her to us, two strangers. And in my mind, I want it to be awesome. I want it to be amazing. I want her to grab me and say, Dad. And I want her to say, Mom. And I want her to say, yes, you guys do so much for us. You love us. You're the best. We can't wait to be a part of the family. That's what we want our daughter to say. But the truth is, she's going to yell and scream and kick and cry because she doesn't know us. And we're taking her from everything she knows. But what my daughter doesn't understand in that moment is that we are offering to her what she most wants. She most wants love. She most wants to be known. She most wants security. She most wants forever family. We are offering that to her, but she doesn't know that. And we are going to persuade her and woo her over the course of time by pouring our love on her, by offering her food and drink and survival. We're literally going to keep her alive. And then we're going to offer her our last name. We're going to offer her an inheritance. We're going to offer her everything we have to offer, just as though she's one of our real kids, because she's ours. And we're going to offer that to her. And by God's grace, we hope that she comes to believe one day that we are for her good and that we are worth trusting. But the way that we get her to do that is by pouring out our love on her, even while she rejects us. And I submit to you that God has been pouring out his love on you, even while you reject him. Because he's your father. He's been keeping you alive and you don't even know. He's been blessing you in 10,000 ways you can't even imagine. And even some of the hard stuff that's gone in your life, he's carried you through some of that stuff, and he's never the bad guy. If you don't hear anything else I hear say today, hear this. God, wherever you're at in your story, God is not the bad guy. Sin is the bad guy. God is good and for you. And God is offering this to you. The question is, will you believe it when you stand at the crossroads? Which way do you want to go? The thing that swayed me to believe this was listening to an author named Brennan Manning. He gave a talk on this, and he's like 70 years old, and he was at the end of his life, and he said, after 50 years of ministry and all these books and all these sermons, here's what I believe. I believe that on Judgment Day, you're going to stand before God, and he's going to ask you one question. So I'm like, wow, what question is this, Brennan? So I like lean in, and here's the question. Brennan Manning thinks that we're going to stand before God, and God's going to ask us, did you believe that I loved you? Did you believe that I loved you? Or did you believe you had to work for it? You had to try harder. You had to be a good person. Or did you believe that I loved you? I loved you and I knew you when you were in your dead state, your broken state, your hurting state, and I intervened with my son Jesus. Do you believe that? And so even to make it a little more personal, and to invite us into that question right now so we don't have to wait till Judgment Day. What if right now we were to say, Jesus came to you in your chair. And Jesus lovingly looked at you and said, hey, I know your whole life story. I know your story better than you do. I know the skeletons in your closet. I know the decisions you've made that have led to darkness. I know what you have done. I know what you're going to do. I know everything about you. But even still, I dare you to believe that I love you. I dare you to believe I love you just as you are, not as you should be. Because you're never going to be as you should be. And the only way you get to be as you should be is by allowing Jesus to love you. And so if he were to come to you and say, will you allow me to love you? Would you let him? Would you let him? So to go all the way back to the beginning, if you were to say, Josh, I'll give you one shot. Why should I believe? I think you should believe, or let me say it this way. I think you should consider believing. Because Jesus is a real person who eyewitnesses saw raised from the dead. And that Jesus loves you, he knows you, he sacrificed for you, and your eternity is at stake. Your eternity is at stake. And we love you enough to tell you that. This is why it's called good news. This is the good news that while we were dead, while we were running the other way, Christ died for us. And that's what we celebrate. The death doesn't have the final verdict over our life, but we can actually be raised from the grave because of what Christ offers and because of how powerful God is. One of the songs we sing says this so beautifully. It says, how deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he would give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. If you feel like a wretch here today, I submit to you that God would love to transition you to becoming his treasure. And the way that happens is by believing in Christ and living eternally and rejecting the fears and rejecting all these other things that are going on in your mind and allowing God to love you.